Hello everyone! In this video, we're going to erase this EEPROM on a breadboard and eventually build a universal ROM programmer. That might not seem like a big deal when modern flash ROMs let you program them with an Arduino, but older ROMs like these need 14 volts to erase them and 12 volts to program them. Some of the older ROMs need over 20 volts to program them, and that means even our trusty $70 TL8662 can't program them reliably. So what we're going to do is to build a programmer that is a lot simpler but still does what the TL8662 can't. And also do it much cheaper. In the first video, we went through how a variable output boost converter works and how we can use that to generate the relatively high and variable voltages we need to erase and program the ROMs. That was a somewhat mixed success, since what we ended up with didn't exactly perform according to the datasheet. And that's probably because we didn't set it up according to the datasheet either, since that called for us to put the inductor and capacitor as close to the pins as possible. And when I put it on the breadboard, I have a feeling I essentially made the breadboard one giant inductor. At the very least, not the inductance I wanted. So to fix that before it causes any more headaches, I'm putting the inductor and input capacitor straight on the breakout board, and that should make quite a difference. By the look of it, the voltage is now spot on, but let's see if it can handle a similar load to what we can expect during erasure. 500 ohms plus the LED current should bring us over the target, and that looks fine. And even if we try to draw 50 milliamps, the voltage doesn't budge. Yay! Since different chips have different requirements, I better also check if we can move the voltage around with a potentiometer. Without doing the math, it looks like we can move the voltage around pretty well, and with a 100k pot instead of R1, we can get it up to 27 volts no problem. That's great! And it means we can even program the higher voltage ROMs. Now, as you can see, I put the ROM all the way to the right, and that's because I have a feeling we'll need all the space on this breadboard later, so I'll just clean that up. In the last video, we also took a look at the erase waveform in the datasheet for the ROM, and it shows we can read out the serial number of the ROM by putting 12 volts on address line 9. Since the resistor divider is set up to make the regulator output 14 volts, we can put a 270k resistor in parallel with R1, which drops the resistance enough to make the output voltage 12 volts instead. We might want to figure out how to control that without swapping resistors in and out later, but for now let's see if we can read the serial number. We now have the 12 volts that we need to put on A9, but of course we also want to control that using our 5V GPIO pin somehow. At first I thought about controlling it using an open collector comparator like the LM339, which is what Garth Wilson suggests in his 6502 potpourri. But since we need more current than we can draw through a pull-up resistor, we would still need another driver to get the current we need. With that in mind, we might as well go back to basics and use cheap bipolar junction transistors, BJTs. So I grabbed some 2N3904s and 6s and designed this circuit. We need two transistors because even though we can turn on the transistor using our 5V logic, we can't turn it off again since the base voltage would need to be higher than the emitter voltage minus the voltage drop of typically 0.7 volts. So we put an NPN low side switching stage in front of it and a pull up to the emitter voltage. That way, when our logic is high, the NPN conducts and pulls the base of the PNP to ground. And when our logic is low, the base of the PNP is pulled to our programming or erasure voltage. You might notice suspiciously identical resistor values. I've chosen 22k, which should, if my math is correct, give enough current through the PNP base to give us around 60 milliamps available from emitter to collector. Easily enough to program the ROM. And by using the same resistor value, we lower the number of different parts, which makes a production run cheaper. So let's grab our 2N3904 NPN transistor, our 2N3906 PNP transistor, the three 22k resistors, and see if we can't use that to switch the 12 volts. First we have the pull-up from emitter to base, and then we connect the emitter to the programming voltage. I better not forget we have a 12V rail on the bottom and a 5V rail on the top. Then I grab the NPN and connect the emitter to ground and put the 22k resistor on the base, ready for an input signal. And then we just connect the collector of the NPN to the base of the PNP with the last 22k resistor. In SMD packages, that's a less than 3-cent solution for controlling higher voltages than our GPIOs can handle. And so we can see what's going on. Let's add an LED. It looks like the NPN does conduct a bit when I touch the base resistor or leave it floating, so we should probably make sure it's always at a defined state, or put a pull-down resistor on the base. Now, where were we? We wanted to erase the EEPROM, so I guess it's about time we actually hook one up and see what we can do with it. First, we need power and ground, and to see what's on the data bus, I made these quick and dirty signal indicators. An LED with a 1500 ohm resistor. 3.3 milliamps should be low enough current that it won't hurt anything, and still enough that we can clearly see if it's on or off. If I connect the chip enable line low, we might already see something if I power it up. It's probably not going to hurt anything if I leave it floating like this. There was a little bit of a blink there, but a pretty clear zero byte out of the data bus if I let it settle. I'll pull the address lines low with 4700 ohm resistors for now, and we should see some data at address 0. I guess the data at address 0 is actually 0. That's kind of a surprise to me since I thought I used the ROM for the 6502 or my bigger 6502 computer for that matter. I guess it's actually the ROM I used to make Pong as a BIOS extension for my IBM PC XT. I guess I'll get back to that project eventually. I have a floppy controller card I need to solder somewhere. But for now, that code needs to go, so it's easier for us to see if things work. I'll just throw the 6502 ROM on there. Since the first instruction is the clear decimal instruction, we should see D8 hex at address 0 now. The LEDs are a bit crooked, but 8 plus 4 plus 1 of the top nibble is 13, and the top bit of the lower nibble makes that 8, so we definitely have D8 hex at address 0. Why does that matter? Well, because now we're going to put 12 volts on address line 9 and leave everything else the way it is, and hopefully the output changes to DA hex, which is Winbond's company ID. Oh, of course, if I disconnect the pull-down resistor and just connect a wire, A9 actually floats high, and we get to see what's at address 512, also known as 200 hex. We can confirm that by making the pull-down a pull-up, but let's leave it as a pull-down on the line. I guess it's a good idea not to forget the pull-down resistor. Of course, we're supposed to control the input to the NPN transistor with a GPIO pin, but for now, let's just see what happens when I connect the base resistor to 5 volts and thereby turn on 12 volts to the ROM's A9 line through the PNP. And it works! Coincidentally, that only flipped a single bit since the first byte in ROM was D8, and the manufacturer serial ID we're reading should be DA. But I'm still super excited about it. We can also read the device serial ID by flipping A0 high, so let's try that with a jumper. And that certainly flipped a few more bits, just like it should, since we're now reading 08 hex. If we flip it back and forth, we'll see it flip between DA and 08 hex. And of course, if we turn off the 12 volts on A9, we see 78 hex at address 1, since we left A0 high. If you're interested in 6502 machine code, 78 hex is the set interrupt disable instruction, which turns interrupts off. I think we've reached the end of what we can do with manually flipping wires, since the erase pulse should be exactly 100 milliseconds plus minus 5%. Probably it won't damage the chip if we're off by a bit, but there's no reason to risk it since we have an easy to use single board computer that can do the timing for us. This time I won't bore you with too much code, but I wrote this tiny bit of userland code we can send to the 6502 via serial when we need to toggle a pin more precisely than I can do by hand. It uses the print byte routine in ROM to print out the current status of the I/O port B to the OLED display, and then it just sets bit 2 of the port low, delays for about 100 milliseconds, and then sets it high again. Bit 2 of port B corresponds to what we call digital pin 8 on an Arduino footprint. Every time we send the code, we can use that to pull the ROM's chip enable line low for 100 milliseconds, and for now, we can still turn the high voltage on and off by hand, since that's not as timing sensitive. To test the code, I've connected it to the base resistor of the NPN, but since I haven't sent the code yet, the pin is still low, since that's what it's set to at reset from ROM code, and our high voltage indicator is off. If I send the code, we should see the LED come on and stay on. And if I send the code again, we should see it blink for a tenth of a second. Yay! Looks like we have the signal we need. Of course, it's not the high voltage we need to control right now, but just the chip enable signal we need to set low while A9 and output enable is at 14 volts. So let's connect our GPIO to the chip enable on the ROM's pin 20. And then we just need to connect our 14 volts. Oh, we still have the resistor in there configuring it for 12 volts, so let's get that out of there. Oh wow, it did not like that. I think it's actually my USB port that didn't like the sudden change and turned it all off. Let's turn it off and see if USB power wakes up again and reconnect everything, this time configuring it for 14 volts. Okay, it's running again, so let's hook it up and... Oh no, what did I just do? The 65Wino has been reset, so the chip enable is already low since we haven't resent the code. And I just connected 14 volts to A9 and output enable. That's certainly a lot more than 100 milliseconds of erase condition already, so either the chip is thoroughly erased or fried. Let's disconnect the GPIO pin and see what happens when we let A9 and output enable go low again. All ones at address 0. That's actually what we want. When we're programming, we only program the zeros, so the erase procedure sets all the bits in the ROM to ones. I'm hoping that means we're lucky and the extended erase condition didn't damage it. So far, it looks like a successful erasure, even if it was a bit unintentional. But let's just reprogram the chip and try that one more time. I'll just put the same code on the chip as before, so we should see D8 hex at address 0 again. Yep, it looks like the chip wasn't damaged, since it programmed and verified fine, and of course we're getting the right data. Now let's just make sure we set up things in the right order so we don't accidentally erase the ROM again. We're still aiming at erasing it, but hopefully less accidentally this time. Again, I just used the high voltage LED as an indicator that the code is loaded, and the GPIO is high before I connect 14 volts and the chip enable line. I might have just left the chip enable floating with erasure voltage going to the other pins. Let's hope that it didn't float low. But now, if I resend the code from the computer, we should get an erase pulse and the ROM should be blank. Moment of truth, let's check. No, that doesn't look right. It looks like bit 2 and 6 are still low, which means they haven't been erased. Let's try that one more time and see if a second erasure changes things. Oh crap, I just did it again, didn't I? I connected the high voltage while chip enable is low, so by now I'm afraid I accidentally erased it again. Yep. I guess the good news is that it's not that hard to erase an EEPROM by hand. Bad news is now I have to reprogram it again to get on with the test. At least you don't have to wait through that. Okay, so chip enable is connected high with the GPIO, and if we connect erase voltage and resend the code, let's see if we erase the same bits again. Of course, one byte is a pretty low sample size, but if the first is bad, we can certainly assume more are bad too. This time it looks like it's only bit 6 that's still low. Maybe something's up with the LED. Yeah, it seems fine. Let's try another erase sequence. Still no luck with that bit. I guess it's time to check some voltages. It looks like we have the erasure voltage we need, but when connecting it to A9 and output enable, the voltage drops to just over 9 volts, which is quite a surprise since we have the PNP transistor configured to pass up to 60 milliamps and programming is only supposed to draw 30 milliamps. Maybe I misunderstood the datasheet and that's 30 milliamps at 14 volts per pin, not total. I took a little detour, double-checking the regulator to make sure it was still putting out the current we need, but through the power of editing, you don't have to go through that with me. If I throw in a 300 ohm resistor making the current 45 milliamps, we see a little drop in voltage to 13.7 volts, but nothing like the drop all the way down to 9 volts. Even though we have the PNP transistor configured to put out 60 milliamps, I guess we're pulling the BJT out of the linear region, and the 22K resistor on the base just isn't sufficient to keep it saturated. If I throw in a 6800 ohm resistor instead of the 22K, we should up the current plenty. According to my new lab assistant, that should put us close to 200 milliamps, which is about what the cheapest of these BJTs can handle. So, if this isn't enough, we might have to look for something with a bit more oomph. But with that in place, it looks like we have a stable 14 volts. Let's see if that didn't make a difference and we can finally put the E into EEPROM. First we hook up the chip enable to the I/O pin, then we turn on the erasure voltage on output enable and A9 on pins 22 and 24, and then I send the code to the 65 Arduino from my desktop one more time to pull the chip enable low for 100 milliseconds. Okay, that should do it. Let's turn off the erasure voltage and see what's at address 0. It looks like we have successfully erased at least one byte. And this time, not even by accident. Great! Just to make sure, let's grab the ROM and read it with MiniPro. I'm pretty sure MiniPro has a blank check, and it looks like that's the B flag, so let's just use that. And success! The whole chip is blank. Of course, we still have a way to go if we want to make this a convenient way to erase and program old chips. So, in the next video, we'll do just that and put the 65 Arduino in control of erasing, writing, and reading EEPROMs, even if they need relatively high voltages. When I gave away a bunch of 65 Arduino boards a little while ago, I was completely taken by surprise by the demand for 6507s, 6532s, and ROMs. But I'm happy to announce they're all back in stock. I also added a few SSD 1306 displays that come in little protective cases, as well as generic 5mm barrel jacks, so you can power the board with up to 18 volts. So, if you'd like to follow along at home, feel free to take a look at my store. Of course, you're still very welcome to have your own board made or follow along on a breadboard. I'd love to hear what you make over on Discord. Either way, thanks for watching.